thank you for the invitation to talk in this very nice summer school. It's a pity that I cannot enjoy a lot more than today of this thing. But it's really nicely organized, and I really have the feeling that I'm on vacation.
We will change that.
So what I'm going to talk about today is some joint work with Alexandru Oancea. And so indeed, the idea is to get an invariant for contact manifolds. And if you are working with holomorphic curves, well, probably the most natural thing that you would like to do if you are really given a contact manifold and not a symplectic manifold is to use something like a contact homology. And so what I would like to start discussing is the simplest version of this invariant, which is the cylindrical version of contact homology. So assume that your manifold, contact manifold, is yxi, and I'll denote the dimension of the contact manifold by 2n minus 1. And as we usually do in these theories, we assume the contact structure to be co-oriented so that it is expressed as the kernel of a one form. And I will assume that this one form is non-degenerate, which you can always achieve by a small perturbation. And so this means that if you have close to a orbit, that is a point P that lies, so that the wave flow after time t for some positive t gets back to p, then if you look at the differential of this wave flow at time t restricted to the contact hyperplane at point p, then this has no eigenvalue equal to 1. And whenever you are in such situations, modulo some choices of trivialization of the contact structure along the trajectory starting and ending at p, then you can associate to such an orbit the Cohn-Lisandro index, or integral valued index for such orbits. So that's one of the ingredients, the choice of a non-degenerate contact form that is necessary to set up this, this theory. And the second ingredient lives at the level of the symplectization of our contact manifold. So this is just the product of y with the real line, equipped with the symplectic form d of e to the t alpha, where t is a coordinate along this, this real line. So that's the symplectization. And on this thing, you can choose J to be a compatible, almost complex structure. With the following properties. The first property is that J preserves the contact distribution, and on it, and that's the meaning of the word compatible here, this is compatible with the symplectic structure D alpha. Second, it maps the vertical direction d over dt along the wheel line to the wave field of our contact form. And finally, j is invariant under translation along the wheel line. So these are the two ingredients you need to set up this homological theory. And once you've made this, this choice, you can consider now moduli spaces. And I denote by m gamma plus gamma minus the moduli space of G holomorphic cylinders, which are maps with two components, A, U, defined on the cylinder, and with values in R times Y, so A will be the height function and U will be the map in the contact manifold. It just means that the differential of this intertwines the obvious complex structure in the cylinder with the almost complex structure G on our symplectization, and with the following asymptotic properties corresponding to this data here in the definition of the moduli space, so such that when you take the limit for S going to plus or minus infinity, so here S stands for the coordinate in the line direction on the cylinder of A of S and let's call theta the angular coordinate on the cylinder, this is plus or minus infinity, and the limit as S goes to plus or minus infinity of U of S theta is going to be given by the orbit gamma plus or minus, and then I need to put some some factor here. No plus minus, it's really plus. So just to take into account the fact that this theta has period one on the circle by choice, by convention, and the orbits, of course, can have different periods for the wave field. And so this is a moduli space in the sense that we are counting, we are putting together solutions of the Cauchy-Riemann PDE with these asymptotic conditions, but modulo by holomorphic reparametrizations of our cylinders and translation in the R direction in the target, since J is invariant under this direction. If you have a solution and you shift it, you get again a solution. So that's the moduli spaces that are central to contact homology, or at least its cylindrical version. And now, big if transversality holds, for the elements of this moduli space, then we know that the dimension of this moduli space will be given by the Fredholm index of this elliptic problem. And its dimension then is given by the difference of the Kohn-Lisinder indices of the asymptotes, minus one coming from the quotient by the R translation. You lose 1 degree of freedom that way. Okay, now let me put aside this important restriction for now. I'll come back to it in a minute. And let's continue with the construction. So now that we have this analytical ingredient, we can construct some algebraic object, namely a chain complex. And so we can define the contact complex, or its cylindrical incarnation. So star will stand for grading of these things. And this will be the Z-module generated by all good closed wave orbits now. What good means is that, well, for every periodic trajectory of the wave field, there exists a shortest trajectory with the same image, right? Now you can compute the Kohn-Lisinder index for the trajectory and its simple counterpart, and it's good if and only if the parities of the Kohn-Lisinder indices coincide. Right? So it's purely numerical, if you wish, easy to check condition on the periodic orbits of your wave vector fields. And this is graded by not exactly the Kohn-Lisinder index, but you shift it by constant n minus 3. Remember that n appears in the dimension of your contact manifold. And the reason for this shift will become apparent in a minute, where conditions will be spelled out and that are more natural to express once the shift like this is made. Now, this is still potentially huge and probably too large for your purposes. So it's sometimes good to restrict yourself to a smaller object. And that we will something we'll typically do. So I pick A, a free homotopy class of loops in Y, and I can restrict myself to those Reeb orbits that are in the class A. Right, so I get something already potentially smaller depending on the topology of my manifolds. So that's just incorporating the Reeb dynamics. And now for the holomorphic cylinders, well, you can define a differential, d sil, by defining d of some orbits that I write gamma plus in analogy with the definition of my moduli space to be the sum over all orbits that I'll denote gamma minus, but with the property that the grading of gamma minus is one less than the grading of gamma plus. You count elements in your moduli space. So here, this is not really the count of elements in the set, it's an algebraic count. You can actually associate a sign to elements in moduli spaces via some coherent orientation construction, but I won't get into that. So you count with signs the elements of this moduli space and you multiply with the corresponding bottom generator. And well, you see the fact that you restrict yourself to a free homotopy class is not an issue because definitely if gamma minus appears in the differential of gamma plus, then they are homotopic because there is a cylinder between them. Right, so you get a differential here. And well, the hope is that you can get a homology theory so that the square of this thing would be equal to zero. But the study of degeneration of holomorphic curves shows that this is not always the case. D sil square is not always going to be equal to zero, and that's because cylinders in our moduli space, if the moduli space has dimension one, so again under transversality assumptions, can also degenerate not only as two consecutive cylinders which would be counted by the square of this differential, but they can also degenerate into another configuration which corresponds to a pair of pans and a holomorphic plane. And here this is a vertical cylinder over a closed Reeb orbit. And so this configuration lives into two separate copies of R times Y. This piece and that piece have each index 1. Right, so if you don't do this R translation business, the index would be equal to 1. So here it's the Conlisander index of the top minus the Conlisander indices of the the grading on the grading on top minus the sum of the gradings on the bottom, and here the grading on the top would be the dimension. And of course, this vertical cylinder is isolated, and so this is index zero. And so if that happens, then definitely d sil square counts degenerations into pairs of cylinders, but it's not equal to zero, it's equal to the count of these objects. And so if we want to get a differential, we need to prevent that sort of phenomenon from happening. And one way of preventing this phenomenon from happening is to prevent this orbit where the breaking occurs from existing. Right? If I call this orbit gamma tilde, then clearly, due to the fact that the index of this element here is 1, the contact homology grading of gamma tilde is equal to 1. And of course, since it bounds a plane, it is a contractible orbit. So this means that if we are under these ideal transversality conditions, we have the following result for this construction. So if again, transversality holds. I'll spell this out in a minute. And if you assume enough to avoid such phenomena, and this means that you ask that the contact complex in the Zeebo free homotopy class vanishes when the grading is equal to 1 Zeebo or minus 1, then d sil squared is equal to 0, and the cylindrical contact homology in class A, which is defined as the homology of that complex, is an invariant of our initial contact manifold. So here, this condition that the complex is trivial in grading 1 corresponds precisely to the assumption I made here. So that's to guarantee that d sil square is indeed equal to 0. So you can define this homology. And these two conditions are necessary to show that this homology is an invariant. Okay, so that's a priori a very nice tool to study contact manifolds. But the big if is this assumption, because it is very, very rarely satisfied. I cannot say exactly under which conditions it is satisfied, but at least I can show you a situation which is, I think, the only situation where we can make a statement in finitely many words where we can be sure that this holds, and you will see that it's pretty restrictive. So transversality rarely holds. And this is, for example, the case if first there are no contractible close to a bobit at all, independently of the grading. So this means that simply connected manifolds you cannot work with. And second, you need to choose the class A, the free homotopy class A that we restrict ourselves to construct the complex, so that it contains only simple closed wave orbits. That is, injective orbits. You cannot have multiplicity greater than 1.
Are these examples of when transversality does hold or when it doesn't?
When it does hold, right? So you need both conditions to be satisfied, and that's an example where it does hold, but I cannot give you very general conditions, more general than this, for which it holds. Maybe in some very specific cases, using some ad hoc argument, depending on which specific manifold you can cook up something, but okay, that's more or less the best we can do. So that's indeed extremely restrictive. And the reason it works is that, if you have these two conditions, you never, of course, have to worry about this kind of situation independently of transversality, because you don't have planes, for one. And second, all the cylinders you are going to work with, since you have simple asymptotes, so injective asymptotes, you can show that the holomorphic cylinders will also be somehow injective near the ends, and by a result of Dragneff, then this is sufficient to be able to choose your almost complex structure as above in a generic way, so that transversality does hold. Right? So that's basically the one case where you can do something with this invariant, but it leaves out a lot of interesting situations.
Can you give an example of the examples?
Sorry?
Can you give an example of the example?
An example of the example, yes. If you take the unit cotangent bundle of some hyperbolic manifold, then the wave flow coincides with geodesic flow, and then you can choose some simple homotopy class that is going to be represented by a geodesic, and you don't have contractible geodesics, and so therefore it works. So that's one big class of manifolds. You can find a few others. I mean, the flat case works as well. If you work on torus, it works as well, but well, that would be my main class of examples, I'm afraid. Okay, so...
Sorry, what does the second star say? And then I just can't read.
So the class A, the free homotopy class A in which we decide to restrict ourselves, contains only simple closed wave orbits. Okay. Right? So that's cheap. You can always choose this class like this. But of course, the difficulty is that maybe this small piece of the invariant would be too small for whatever you want to do with it, right? So that's also a possible restriction. Okay, so that's quite frustrating that we cannot make these things work, at least without polyfolds.
Is your Reeb orbit in this example that you don't want to arise, is that hyperbolic or elliptic? assume in dimension 3.
If you're in dimension 3, this is a hyperbolic orbit, isn't it? Yes, thank you. Yes. Okay, so let's see what else we could do in order to salvage the situation and still have something that is pretty similar to this construction, but that will work in much greater generality than these very heavy restrictions. And one way to do that is to adopt some symplectic point of view and work with S1 equivariant symplectic homology. Okay, so the big difference between contact homology and symplectic homology is that now we are really in Fleur theory. And for Fleur theory, you need an extra ingredient, which is a Hamiltonian function. So let's consider first an easy model of a Hamiltonian function, small h, defined on our symplectic manifolds, namely the symplectization of y. And assume that this h behaves as in the following schematic picture. I'm going to draw a sketch of the graph of h. As a function, it will depend only on the t coordinate here. And instead of writing t as the variable, I'll write the variable to be exponential of t. Right? So this means that it takes value from 0 to infinity. And this small h, I will give it some asymptotic conditions. I ask for that very large values of parameter this function is a piece of line with a big slope, so it will be something of the form capital T times e to the t, plus some constant beta, whatever. And on the other hand, near the origin, I ask that it start with a very small slope, so it's also linear there, with a small slope. And then in between, you just interpolate.
E
to the t, indeed, yes. I can even get confused myself with this, don't worry. Okay, so now, if you choose such a Hamiltonian function, well, you have to look at what the Hamiltonian vector field associated with this is doing, because these are really the meaningful orbits in Fleur theory. And this Hamiltonian vector field is actually going to be minus the derivative of this function h with respect to not t, but this other variable e to the t multiplied with the wave field. Right? So that's what you easily find out. And this means that one periodic orbit of the Hamiltonian vector field are in bijective correspondence with closed Reeb orbits, but with the constraint that the periods of this orbit cannot take values that are obtained by this, this derivative, which is between something very small. So you can assume that there is no period of a closed Reeb orbit between the slope and zero, if you take the slope sufficiently small, and t. Right? So these are closed Reeb orbits with periods in interval 0, t. And in order to avoid unpleasantnesses, I will assume that this final slope capital T is chosen generically so that it is not a period for the Reeb field. Right? So definitely, you will not have closed orbits in this region. So all the periodic orbits will actually be contained in the compact region of your symplectization. OK, so that's a very nice Hamiltonian, easy to understand. But you cannot quite work with such a Hamiltonian to do a standard Fleur theory, because this vector field is independent of time. And therefore, if you work with a parameterized one periodic orbit of this vector field, then as soon as you have one, you have a whole family of it of them, because you can reparameterize, you can shift the parametrization, right? And in Fleur theory, you work with parameterized orbits. And so you are going to use another Hamiltonian, capital H, which depends on time, so this periodic time, S1 of length 1, and of course on our symplectization. And this capital H, which is going to be a suitable theta-dependent perturbation of this small h. So what do I mean by suitable? Well, I would like to understand, in fact, the correspondence, and continue to be able to understand the correspondence between one periodic orbits of the Hamiltonian vector field and my closed Reeb orbits. What happens is that in order to perturb, what you will typically need to do is to use this theta dependence. You can view this as a function on the circle. And along each closed Reeb orbit, you are going to introduce a perturbation by a function on the circle. And if you choose this to be a Morse function, then each critical point of the Morse function will give rise to one periodic orbit of the perturbed Hamiltonian field. And so in order to avoid having zillions of periodic trajectories after the perturbation, you are going to choose the minimal number of critical points for a function, a Morse function on the circle, namely 2. Right? So the suitable perturbation is chosen so that one periodic orbit of or time-dependent Hamiltonian vector field for capital H are actually given by a pair of orbits that I'll denote by gamma check and gamma hat for each closed Reeb orbit gamma with periods between 0 and t. Okay, so that's really are going to be the interesting guy. So two generators, or two orbits, two Hamiltonian orbits per closed Reeb orbit that we had in the contact picture. Okay, so now that we have introduced this extra ingredient, then we can make a definition for symplectic invariant. Now, if we were simply doing ordinary Fleur theory, you would need to work with a symplectic complex, which is a Z module generated by all these one periodic orbits of the time-dependent Hamiltonian vector field. This is again going to be graded by Conley's Zender index. And for consistency with the previous definition, I will ask that this is graded by Conley's Zender index plus the same shift n minus 3 as before. So this differs a little bit from the usual conventions in literature that are meant for symplectic homology. Here I'm twisting the picture to make it look like the contact invariant. Okay, so that would be the complex we would use for the ordinary Fleur theory, but that's not what we are doing. We are going to do some S1 equivariant version of that. And so second layer is to define an S1 equivariant version of that of the Fleur complex. And so this is going to be based on a different Z module, which is obtained by taking the usual construction, the usual Z module, tensored over the coefficients in Z with a polynomial ring in one formal variable U, which has degree equal to 2. Right? So that seems like a kind of arbitrary definition at this point.
What happened to your gamma check and gamma hat?
No. They are not forgotten. It's just that when I say generated by one periodic orbits of these things, this includes both gamma checks and gamma hats for all possible gammas.
Oh, I see. And what's the difference in the next one?
Oh, yeah, the idea is that, yes, the check is like an arrow going down, so it's one index one less, and hat is like an arrow going up, so index one more, right? The index differs by one. It's the most index on the circle, right? But I'm not going to use the check and hat notation anymore because I don't really need to. So I just did that, you know. Doesn't really matter.
So does this context depend on T?
Sorry?
Does this context depend on T? So, T.
T, so the theta is the variable in the r direction, yes? Ah, capital T, yes. Of course, you are limited to periodic orbits with a period up to T, so indeed, it's a choice. At some point, we'll need to remove that choice later in the construction. But at this point, yes, it depends on many things. It depends on T, on the choice of Hamiltonian, many things, right? It's only at the end of the construction that you will end up with an invariant, right? And then on this Z module, I need to define something that will play the role of a differential, right? So I'll denote this by ds1. And this ds1, well, I need to say what it does on each of these factors here. And you can decompose this as a sum for k from 0 to infinity. Index k corresponds to the effect on the polynomial ring, because it will lower the power of u by k. Now, if you have a polynomial with degree less than k, this actually kills the polynomial. So it means that even though the sum is infinite, if you act on a given element in here, you only have finitely many terms contributing. Right, so you don't have any convergence issue. It's just formal notation. On any every given element, there are finitely many terms. And then, on this factor, you act by some map. And I will denote for now this map as phi k. And I will need more time to define what is this phi k, because it will be counting solutions of some moduli problem. Right. So that's the general form of the differential.
Why did you say that it's actually a finite sum?
Because by definition or convention, the effect of this lowering the degree of u by k has the effect on a polynomial of degree less than k of killing the polynomial, right? Okay, so to start slowly, and for those who are not quite familiar with Fleur theory, let me say what phi zero is going to count. So phi zero is going to count solutions of the Fleur equation and so these are maps U tilde. I don't need to distinguish between the R and the Y factors anymore, defined on the cylinder and with values in our symplectic manifold, such that du tilde over ds plus j of du tilde over d theta minus, that's the effect of the Hamiltonian now, the Hamiltonian vector fields along our cylinder is equal to zero, and u tilde of s and theta converges when s goes to plus or minus infinity to some one periodic orbit of the Hamiltonian field. And here I'm putting a tilde because it's not a wave orbit where I used naked gammas, but it's a Hamiltonian orbit. That's the only meaning of this tilde. Okay, so that's the Fleur equation. Now notice, of course, that this equation is theta dependent due to the Hamiltonian vector field. And so this means that there is no reason that we should keep exactly the same data, capital J, as we used to have in the contact situation where we had one almost complex structure. We can have an S1 family of almost complex structures. We can choose this J to be theta dependent as well. So there is already a theta here. So that's one big difference between the contact construction I explained before and this construction, is that now you can choose, you have a wider choice of geometric data because you can choose your almost complex structure to depend on the variable theta. And that's actually quite important because whatever the orbits are actually doing in the manifold, since the geometric data depends on theta, orbits are as good as simple somehow for transversality purposes. And so this means that in practical situations, we will be able to choose generic theta-dependent J to achieve transversality for such moduli spaces. Right? And that's a big advantage compared to the previous construction.
And the index difference is 1, right?
The index, yes. The guys that are counted by phi zero corresponds to the fact that gamma plus minus gamma minus minus one is equal to zero, right? The same dimension vanishes, yes.
So you're sort of just adding another parameter to
the
give you more control over transversality?
Yes, it actually enlarges the space of geometric data you're working with, yeah. So that with this wider choice, you have enough to get genericity. Okay, so that was just phi zero. Now I have to repeat that infinitely many times to give you the differential. And so, more briefly, phi k will count not just maps u tilde, but tuples composed of such maps, but also of parameters that I call tau bar and L bar. The bar just stands there to say that these are vectors, in fact, because tau bar will live in S1 to the power k, while L bar will live in R plus to the power k minus 1. So there are components for each of these two pieces of data. And these things will be solutions of, well, again, some Fleur type equation. So I'm writing down the same type of equation, but now the difference is that both my almost complex structure and my Hamiltonian vector field also depends in some way on the variable s, the real direction along the cylinder. And of course, I need to tell you how these more general ingredients are defined out of the original Hamiltonian H and the original almost complex structure J theta. And need some room to explain this. Sorry?
What's little s?
Little s is the variable in here. One of the two variables for your cylinders. So j of s theta will be constructed from the original j that depends only on theta, on from that j here, by setting theta equal to some function beta of s and theta. And similarly, this Hamiltonian up there that depends both on s and on theta, so the theta dependence was implicit, but it was always there, of course, will be our original Hamiltonian, but with variable theta being set equal to some function beta of s theta. And so now, what I have to tell you is what is this function, this function beta of s theta, how it is defined over the cylinder. And so to do this, let me draw schematically how it depends on s. So that's my real line with the s variable. Okay, so for s less than zero, you take beta equal simply to theta. So that's the old equation, right? You set theta equal to itself, and it's like the ordinary Fleur equation. Now, after one, things are changing, and they will be changing until you hit the first component of this L vector. And in this region, it will be theta minus tau 1. So basically, you are shifting the angle by some other angle, tau 1, which is the first component of this parameter up there. And here in between, you have some interpolation. And then between L1 and L1 plus 1, you will leave this constant region to do some interpolation with the next one, where you shift by tau 2. And you will keep this constant value until you hit L1 plus L2. Again, you have interpolation here. Here, for duration 1, you have again interpolation, and you go on like this until you hit the last special moment, which is L1 plus ta-ta-ta plus Lk minus 1. Right? And for duration 1, you have interpolation, and after that, you have the final value theta minus tau, and the last guy is tau k. And so that's what the map beta is doing. So actually, if you forget momentarily about these interpolation regions, you are just simply rotating the cylinder by differing angles tau, and in some finitely many regions of given size, you interpolate between these different torsions for the Fleur equation.
Does the tau increase, or you don't care?
So, what we are going to do now is to count triplets of solutions. So tau can take any value. Just looking for tau so that there exists a solution u. Just looking for tau and for L's so that this twisted equation, this complicated S-dependent equation, has a solution. Right? And so this means that if you really look at the Fredholm index of that, and then you freeze temporarily tau and L, if you freeze tau and L and you look at this this equation, you will typically look for solutions that have a negative index. And the index will raise and go back up to zero only because of the presence of tau and L. Because you have the freedom of varying tau and L to search for solutions, that you will eventually find some solutions. And that's the guys that you are going to count in the map phi k. Right? So, really, phi k counts cylinders, but the cylinders themselves, u tilde alone, has negative index, right? Unlike what happened before, when it had index 1. Right? Because each time you increase k by 1, you are introducing two real parameters, one extra tau, one extra L, and so the index is going to be lowered by one. Right? So the candidate U tildes have index, well, before it used to be one, but now you subtract 2k. Right? And so this means that phi k will have grading, so the effect of phi k of the grading will be the opposite of that, 2k minus 1, but then u shifts down by 2k, so the end is you shift by 1, and so indeed the all terms, and therefore this differential, has the effect of lowering the degree by 1. So everything is as it should be. Okay, so so that's the definition of this S1 equivariant differential. So it looks a little bit strange and coming out of blue, this definition with multiple twists. So if I want to say in a nutshell, what is this DS1? Well, DS1, if you only start writing the first few terms of this infinite expansion, this is going to be first phi zero, but phi zero is the usual Fleur differential, it counts the usual things. Plus u inverse multiplied by phi 1, but phi 1 will have no L variables, there will be only one twist between theta and theta minus some tau, right? A single twist, and this phi 1 is typically denoted by delta, and this, we are familiar with S1 equivariant theories, is the BV operator. And then you have higher terms in U inverse that will come in. And the reason for the presence of these terms, right, you might say, okay, that's if you know about S1 equivariant theories, incorporating the BV operator should be enough somehow to have an S1 equivariant theory. Well, the thing is that these two terms alone do not square to zero. So the presence of these terms is to guarantee that the square of this thing is equal to zero, in fact. Okay, so that's the definition of this S1 equivariant complex. And so now what's the result about this? Well, the result obtained jointly with Alex Oancea is that if we assume that the usual symplectic complex vanishes if the degree does not exceed 1. So that's slightly stronger than asking that the contact complex was 0 when the degree was minus 1, 0, and 1, because you ask that for all negative degrees, but in many, many classes of examples, it's not really an additional restriction. So that's still a relatively nice assumption. So if you have that, then this S1 equivariant differential squares indeed to zero, and the S1 equivariant homology, I need to denote a plus because that's the notation, I mean, there is another guy that has no plus and that's something different, but in this context I need to put a plus, which is defined, of course, by taking the homology of this complex, so this, of course, will remove a lot of the dependence, right, on the choice of J, of the Hamiltonian H, capital H, perturbing the small Hamiltonian H. But indeed, the small Hamiltonian H does depend on capital T. So I need now to remove the capital T dependence. And it turns out that this collection of homologies fit into a directed system with respect to this parameter T. And one can take the direct limit when capital T goes to infinity so that we consider all close to abobits in the theory. And the result of this is going to be an invariant of or initial contact manifold. Right? And the big gain compared to the previous story is that the assumption is just an assumption on the dynamics. Is satisfied a lot more often than the very restrictive conditions that were necessary here for transversality. Right? That's a big gain. And so we get now a device that we can use instead of linearized contact homology for this for contact manifolds.
I think this may be the first time a plus has appeared in your notation.
Yes. yes, oh, sorry, here, yes. Yeah, I should have. It doesn't matter. I mean, okay, here it's just that if I don't work with a symplectization, but if I work with a symplectic manifold with convex boundary, then there are two objects. There is the S1 without plus and S1 with plus. And somehow this corresponds to the plus version because the filling and generators that would be inside the filling, in the interior of the filling, are not contained. But it just to fit with these other cases, but if you concentrate purely on symplectizations, who cares? I mean, right. Yes?
What if you have chosen h, the function h, yes, is linear, but with an increasing slope?
Quadratic, for example. Yes, you can do that well. The price to pay, of course, is that all the action, if you like, is not contained in a compact region because you go up to infinity, but you can also do this sort of thing. I mean, this has been done in the standard Fleur theory by various authors, right? So, then you don't need to take the limit anymore because then you're done immediately, yes. But there is a little bit of extra care of complexity to take care of the fact that you are not in a compact region, etc. But then you don't have to do that anymore, so, you know, just matter of taste. Not really crucial. Okay, so now maybe let me explain quickly why this assumption is sufficient to guarantee that the theory works and that we have no transversality issues. So what is really the key argument in this story? Well, a priori, Fleur-type cylinders, and by this I mean Fleur cylinders of that nature, but also the more general type of Fleur equation satisfying this twisted equation, right? Fleur type cylinders can also, if you look at them of in one parameter families, this is typically what you are looking at when you want to prove that d square is equal to zero. Well, they can also degenerate instead of degenerating into two consecutive cylinders, they could also degenerate as a pair of pans in a plane. And the way it happens is a little bit different here because we are working with Hamiltonian trajectories that are in a compact region of our symplectization. But it might be that there is some arm that develops that goes down, and in the end it hits the negative end at minus infinity of the symplectization, and then you need to look down in another copy of that symplectization, and what you recover is a genuine J-holomorphic plane, or J-theta holomorphic plane, for some fixed value of theta, and which value of theta depends on where the gradient blow-up occurred, right? So whenever you have a picture like this, then the bottom part is as bad as this used to be in the contact homology situation for transversality purposes. So that's really cannot hope to do anything good with that. However, the top part is much better because you always have these asymptotes here where J and H both depend on theta. And therefore there is room enough to perturb this and achieve transversality here. Right? So we can achieve transversality for the top part. Not necessarily for the bottom part, but you can for the top part. So now let's look at this orbit gamma tilde, where the breaking occurs, right? We want this breaking not to occur. Well, given our assumption, this orbit has no choice but to have grading strictly bigger than one. So since the grading is bigger than one, then Well, if you look at the dimension of a moduli space, so right now it's one before you break, but after you break, the top piece, the dimension of the top moduli space is going to be 1 minus this extra negative puncture. But that's negative now. And since you have transversality, then you know that the top subject cannot exist, otherwise you would have a contradiction. Right? And so that's how this assumption is sufficient to guarantee the existence of this theory, because transversality can work in the top part. Right? That's really the key reason for this to work. Okay, so that's a nice alternative to linear-IHES contact homology. Actually, it's more than that. It's more than that because our initial motivation with Alex Oancea was to understand the relationship between symplectic and contact point of view for holomorphic curve invariants. And, well, if both invariants are defined, and this means that you have to assume these strong transversality assumptions for contact homology. So if transversality holds, for the linearized, the cylindrical contact homology, and of course the assumptions there also holds, SC is trivial if the degree four degree less or equal than one, then in fact the two objects, on the one hand the cylindrical version restricted say to a free homotopy class A, and the symplectic version. Now again, I can play the same game but restrict myself to free homotopy class A, right? Since I'm working with cylinders, of course, the complex field splits according to this free homotopy class. Well, these two things will actually be isomorphic, but careful, they will not be isomorphic as Z modules, but over Q coefficients. Right, so the torsion, in principle, may not agree. But over rational coefficients, these two things are actually the same whenever both are defined. Of course, this is not often defined without heavy machinery like polyfolds, but okay, the aim of this, the meaning of this theorem is that really, philosophically, this should be thought as a substitute for that object in all situations, and since it is defined a lot more generally, then all applications that you have in mind that you could accomplish with cylindrical contact homology, you can then do them completely rigorously for contact manifolds with that object instead. Right? So that's the idea. And the intuition of why this works only over rational coefficients and doesn't work over Z is the following. We can make a comparison between this complicated symplectic contact theory and something a lot simpler in algebraic topology, where you have a topological space X with a circle action. And we can assume further that the circle action has no fixed points. So by this I mean that there is no point in X which is fixed by the whole circle, but there are roots of unity of the neutral element that fixes some point of X. Right? That can still occur, but no point of X is fixed by the full circle. That's what I mean. No fixed point for the fullest one. Then, if you have such a space with an S1 action and you want to cook up some homological invariants, there are two possibilities. Either, if you want really to take into account this S1 action, you take the quotient, and then you take the homology of the quotients. But of course, this object is, you know, if X was a manifold, this is not going to be a manifold anymore, so it behaves not as well as X itself, so its homology conceivably also does not satisfy very nice properties either. Or you keep the S1 action in store to define a more adapted homology, which is an S1 equivariant homology for this topological space, and you get something that is typically better behaved. And the thing is that this homology of quotient corresponds philosophically to the cylindrical contact homology, while the S1 equivariant counterpart corresponds to SHS1 plus. Right? And now on this side here, on the left, using a pure algebraic topology argument, under this assumption for the circle action, then these coincide over Q, but not over Z.
I meant to ask you, I thought your SH had some new coefficient, so it was really over a ring Z where you'd adjoined U. So don't you have to tensor the cylindrical homology by Q over passing Z? I mean, what happened to that U?
U is simply hanging around. I mean, your generators in these things are just tensor products of orbits and powers of U.
But you don't consider it to be a ring over Z module. I mean,
No. I consider that as a Z module or as a Q vector space after a tensor with Q. But I just keep U itself, and I don't. For these constructions, I don't use U or its structure to get something additional. No. You could do that, but here I'm not doing that. Right? So okay, there is U, and the generators are just orbits with extra power of U, but you know, that's just what it is.
I think CH cell is not even invariant over Z. I think there is no definition currently existing corresponding to H star of X minus 1.
Right, I mean,
we have counterexamples to show that it's not invariant over Z.
Oh yes, I pretty much can believe that. I mean, but you know, if you place yourself in extremely restrictive condition,
yeah. Assuming all the orbits are simple.
In those cases, yes, then it's defined, etc. But in more generality, it's not even clear indeed that this is properly defined over Z. Yes, but while this other part here is defined and is invariant over Z, right? So that's an extra advantage to this version of the invariant, right? It's the Z features of it, polyfold or not, then you get something well defined over Z. And so
in this analogy, what is X? Is it some space of loops?
Yes. So what X should be conjecturally is a space of loops that are positively transverse to the construct structure. That's what it should be. But that's a conjecture. Now, if you work with cotangent bundles or unit cotangent bundles, then you can actually prove such statements with a loop space on the base. Right? So then it's a theorem. Right? But in more generality, I mean, that's these positively transverse loops play the natural role, but we just know we don't know how to prove this. Right? And so I'm already over time, so I just want to finish by saying that indeed applications. Applications that were already done or thought of using cylindrical contact homology can indeed and have been obtained via this invariant. The price to pay for using the right-hand side instead of the left-hand side is that it's more complicated to compute, right? It's not purely G holomorphic curves and you have all these extra things, guys like this to work with, right? But it is possible to do that. And so some applications of this S1 equivariant symplectic homology have been obtained by Jean Gut, who was a joint PhD student of Alex Oancea and myself. For example, he showed that the calculation of this invariant coincides with this one for the Buiscorn spheres considered by Ustilovsky to show that there are infinitely many contact structures on 4k plus 1 dimensional spheres, and also obtained some results about the multiplicity of simple closed wave orbits on contact manifolds using this object. Thank you.
Any questions?
Could you please comment on is that invariant being an invariant of white side? The contact.
Here?
No. Upper border.
Ah, here.
Yes. So you say that it's a contact invariant. Could you please? Remember? So why is it independent of the filling?
But there is no filling. It's a symplectization. I never talked about any filling. There never was a filling. So it's a symplectic point of view on a contact, on a purely contact situation. There is no filling. No, this construction works without a filling. Right? Of course, you can play symplectic homology, and that's what's usually done with a symplectic manifolds with convex boundary, blah, blah, blah. But here, I'm just explaining that if you don't have that, if you simply have a contact manifold, provided you make a suitable assumption, namely this one, then it can work with a symplectization alone.
Any other questions? Yes. Frédéric, yeah. Very nice talking. Oh, there is one?
I had it, yeah. So this assumption on SC star is equal to zero.
Yes.
I guess it depends on the manifold or something.
Yeah. Of course. I can show you examples of manifolds where this is not satisfied, but in many nice cases it is satisfied. So it's going to work for already wide classes of contact manifolds. So there are definitely many applications you can derive out of this compared to what you had here.
Frédéric for a really nice talk, and we'll start again in a couple of minutes.